Good morning and welcome to St. Mark's Episcopal Church in Highland, Maryland. We are actually filming, as I have for the last several weeks, from our deck in Ellicott City, Maryland. My name is Taylor Smith. I am the rector of St. Mark's, and I want to say again how sorely I miss our community. A couple things to remind you before we start. One is that we offer services of Compline every single night at 9 p.m. You can get to those through our website at stmarkshighland.org. We also offer services of morning prayer at 9 a.m. on Wednesday mornings, and you can get to those from our homepage as well. Each of those starts 1/2 hour before the service. The meeting opens up so that people can come in and visit if they would like to. Second announcement, many of you will remember Derek Miller, who was an intern with us last fall. Derek has continued on in the process of ordination. He has been made a postulant, which is the unnecessarily fancy word that means he is continuing in the ordination process. He's reached the next level and now has the go-ahead to go to seminary. So hopefully he will be joining the church in an ordained manner before long. And that is, I promise you, a good thing for the church. I want to thank those who helped me out this morning, especially Daniel Buettner and Bonnie Dixon for doing readings, and Dick Mitchell for doing the prayers of the people. I also want to tell you that we are going to try something new this morning. We're going to try a virtual coffee hour. So when we are finished with the service, I will open up a Zoom meeting. You can find that link in your email if you have signed up for our emails. I did not want to post it publicly because we would risk Zoom bombing. So it's widely available. You can share it with people, but that's where you'll find it, and we'll give it a try and see how it goes. Finally, just a note about today's service. We will be doing functionally morning prayer, but it will feel familiar. We'll start with the first half of the Eucharist, and we will start the beginning of the Great Thanksgiving through the Salvation History, which is just a couple paragraphs. And then we will say the Lord's Prayer and the General Confession from morning prayer and close. So that's it. I would like to offer now the opening song.
We all start on the outside, the outside looking in, this is where grace begins. We were hungry, we were thirsty, with nothing left to give, oh, the shape that we were in. Just when our hope seemed lost, love opened the door for us. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table. Come meet this motley crew of misfits, these liars and these thieves. There's no one unwelcome here. So that sin and shame that you brought with you, you can leave it at the door and let mercy draw you near. Come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table. Come to the table.
To the thief and to the doubter, to the hero and the coward, to the prisoner and the soldier, to the young and to the older, all who hunger, all who thirst, all the last and all the first, all the paupers and the princes, all who failed, you've been forgiven, all who dream and all who suffer, all who've loved and lost another, all the chained and all the free, all who follow, all who lead, anyone who's been shut down, all the lost you have been found, all who've been labeled right or wrong, to everyone who hears this song. Come to the table, come join the sinners who have been redeemed, take your place beside the Savior, sit down and be set free. Come to the table.
Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. O God, whose Son Jesus is the Good Shepherd of your people, grant that when we hear his voice, we may know him who calls us each by name and follow where he leads, who with you in the Holy Spirit, he lives and reigns, one God forever and ever. Amen. And now we will hear from the Holy Scriptures.
A reading from the book of Acts. Those who had been baptized devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Awe came upon everyone, because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all, as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
A reading from the book of Peter. It is a credit to you if, being aware of God, you endure pain while suffering unjustly. If you endure when you are beaten for doing something wrong, what credit is that? But if you endure when you do right and suffer for it, you have God's approval. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example, so that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When he was abused, he did not return abuse. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he entrusted himself to those who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that, free from sins, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. For you were going astray like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Jesus said, Very truly, I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way, is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him because they do not know the voice of strangers. Jesus used this figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So again, Jesus said to them, "Very truly, I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who come before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it abundantly." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. In the name of Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep. Amen. This past summer, the youth group had the opportunity to take their pilgrimage, which we do every 2 years through the generosity of the parish. And I had the great joy of going with them. And we ended up going to a ranch out in South Dakota. In this just stunningly beautiful area of the country. One of the highlights of the trip was a hike up the tallest point in South Dakota, which is a mountain called Black Elk Peak. The trail seemed rugged to me, but I am not really a climber, by which I am not at all a climber. But it was in a state park, so the trail was maintained. But it was long, it was steep, and it was hot outside. As we pushed to the top, I was bringing up the rear. I'm going to tell you that my recollection is that as a chaperone, I was asked to bring up the rear to, we don't want to lose any of the kids. However, I think it's more accurate that it was the natural course of things that I ended up at the back of the pack. Anyway, just a little way below the summit, we caught up to the group in front after we'd been huffing and puffing, so that was nice. They had stopped to take a break and, very importantly, to let us catch up. When we caught up and everyone was together, they were ready to go, so off they went. After all, they had been waiting for a while. I think I lost it. I was exhausted and they could not go the moment we got there. We needed a break. Now, I shouldn't speak for other people to say that everyone was exhausted, but I was. I needed that break. I'm not proud to say I may have actually snapped at a couple people. So if I snapped at you and offended you, I'm sorry. But I needed to stop. I needed a breath. I needed to look around to see what it is that we'd gotten into. Now, the reason this experience, or maybe it'd be more accurate to say this episode, comes to mind is because it's reminiscent of the setting in Acts. We had this morning a reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Remember that the book of Acts is the story of the founding of the church in the period after Jesus' resurrection. And by the second chapter, where we are this morning, there had already been a lot going on. The book of Acts gets off to a flying start. There was the extraordinary conversation between the resurrected Jesus and his apostles. And then Matthias was chosen to replace Judas Iscariot. And then came Pentecost, the arrival of the Holy Spirit as promised. On that first Pentecost, Peter took up the mantle of leadership, overcoming, I should note, the bumbling journey he made through the Gospels. Peter stepped up and was now a leader, and he preached an amazing sermon given the response. He proclaimed that God had untied the ropes of death from around Jesus Christ, that Jesus had indeed been raised up, and that death was no match for him. He preached salvation and hope in Jesus Christ. His sermon perplexed the crowds, but if you're going to measure a sermon by the number of people it converts, he brought in 3,000 people that day. Anyway, after this flurry of activities in the first two chapters, the final paragraph of the second chapter gives us, readers and seekers, a chance to take a breath, a chance to look around, a chance to see where we had gotten to. It's not dissimilar from showing up on that trail at the group ahead. Now, Acts uses that break to assess, in just a few verses, the nature of the infant church. And it begins with these words: those who had been baptized devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Does that sound familiar? It should. This is one of those passages that longtime Episcopalians like to think is a good example of where the Bible quotes the prayer book. It's nice that it does it so often. But that's because a little but very important piece of our baptismal covenant comes directly from that passage. Every time we baptize someone or renew our own baptismal covenant, which we are going to do in a few moments, we follow a form grounded in the practices of the church going back generations. We start by reciting the Apostles' Creed, which is one of the earliest delineations of Christian belief. After that, the covenant demands that we make five sacred commitments. So the Apostles' Creed is about what we believe as Christians. These commitments are about who we are and who we intend to be as Christians. And these five commitments include things like resisting evil, about repenting and returning to God, about proclaiming the good news of God in Christ, seeking and serving our Lord Jesus in everyone we meet. We recommit ourselves to love our neighbor. We strive for justice and peace, and we commit to respect the dignity of everyone on this planet. It is a tall order and one that is hard to live up to. But all of these commitments begin with this question: will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in the prayers? It is straight out of the book of Acts. If you were nearby right now, I feel certain that I would hear you all say, "I will, with God's help." These days, frankly, this might be one of the tallest orders, given where we are. That verse from Acts is often regarded as laying down what some call the four marks of the church: the apostles' teaching, the fellowship of believers, the breaking of bread, and the prayers, the four marks. Commentators, it's interesting, given where we are now, commentators over the years assert that these four marks are all essential to our life in the church. One says, these four go together. You can't separate them or leave one out without damaging the whole thing. Another asserts, where people ignore the common life of the Christian family, they become isolated and often find it difficult to sustain a living faith. Where people no longer share regularly in the breaking of the bread, they are failing to raise the flag which says Jesus' death over resurrection is, and resurrection are the center of everything. He goes on to say, imagine a world without the breaking of the bread. Life would be bleak indeed, just as it is for people who embrace a relentlessly secular lifestyle. And yet here we are, church in the age of a killer virus. Imagine a world without the breaking of the bread. Well, I have to say that I am getting tired of preaching about coronavirus, and I feel quite certain you all are getting tired of hearing me preach it. But here we are, trying to be church without gathering to break the bread, to share in the Holy Eucharist. The faithful, of course, can watch it on their computers or their phones, which is a remarkable thing, but they cannot partake. It sometimes feels, I think, under the circumstances that we simply can't be church together. But I want to say that that feeling is not truth. With diligence and ingenuity, we can take the other three marks and make ourselves church. Despite being holed up in our homes, we can certainly continue in the Apostles' teaching. Wednesday morning Bible study at St. Mark's has persevered. There are small groups at St. Mark's who are already moving forward with components of Christian education. Not the least of these is the Wednesday morning Bible study. which has persevered. I'm currently considering a few ways to take on that task more broadly with education, more broadly in the parish. Some have suggested or asked me if we could restart Lentflix, and that's a distinct possibility. I think we need to rename it. I don't know, Easterflix, or I don't know, maybe somebody can come up with a better name. Anyway, where was I? The prayers, another of the marks. Continuing in the prayers, I think, is an easy one. In fact, in my nearly 8 years at St. Mark's, I have never known the parish to be more dedicated to prayer. Every night, every single night, we have 20 to 25 people in a Zoom meeting to say Compline, this service at the end of the day in preparation for bedtime. In addition, St. Mark's has been doing morning prayer on Wednesday mornings for years, and we are still doing it. And not only do we have our full complement of regulars, we're getting people who are not able to come when we are not holed up, because for better or for worse, their impending obligations have drifted away and they're able to join us. And people have shared with me that they are committing themselves to daily morning prayer, which is just a remarkable thing. Prayer is alive and well at St. Mark's, in addition to the Sunday morning distant Eucharists. And where fellowship is concerned, I have to say that Zoom is giving a much stronger sense of community than I ever would have imagined. It turns out that seeing people while you talk to them, as opposed to the phone, is a huge part of being in relationship. And in my experience, the ease of the process is making interactions more frequent. For example, I'm seeing my small clergy group once a week instead of once a month. They are an invaluable resource to me. I'm seeing over 100 clergy and our bishops once a week instead of once a year. I'm seeing my brother and sister from Boston and Montana in a weekly Zoom call with my mother, who is in an assisted living home and can't be visited. Being so spread out, my brother and sister and I are only used to talking every few months, honestly, at best. Now I'm seeing them weekly. It is a wonderful, marvelous thing. And actually, it gets better. On our call on Friday, we had several of our cousins join in. We invited them, sent them the link, and they joined in. And we had, my father's side, we have 9 cousins in my generation, and 7 of us were together. I haven't seen some of those cousins in years. What a joy it was to catch up with them. And I'm seeing so many of you more regularly than I would otherwise, not the least of which being at Compline and at morning prayer. Remember, we gather half an hour before those services so that people can visit, and we really have a marvelous mixture of fellowship and prayer, living into 2 of the 4 marks. The bottom line is, I don't feel nearly as separated from our community as I thought I would. I'm still sad. I still want to be with you all, but this stuff is helping. Fellowship is not perfect this way, but neither is it dead. And while outreach is not defined as one of the 4 marks of the church, it is a crucial element to being church. And I am overwhelmed with joy to see St. Mark's efforts at outreach continue to prosper. In fact, donations to the Guardian Angel Food Pantry are flourishing, and Rich and Diane Rocha are to be commended for their dedication at taking the donated food to the people in the neighborhood of Remington at Church of the Guardian Angel weekly. It was already a food insecure neighborhood, so you can imagine what it is now. So we can do the Apostles' teaching in fellowship and say the prayers. Perhaps this pandemic is providing rest on the trail of life. Life forces us to climb that mountain day after day, and maybe we are currently on that break that so many desperately need, if not for their spiritual life, then physical life, or then for their spiritual life. Even the group ahead of you on the trail has had to stop, to take a breath, to look around, to see where we are and where we've gotten to. Our inability to break bread can't and won't stop us from being church. In fact, as this crisis took root, Bishop Sutton reminded us of something we already knew, and that is that our buildings are not the church. We are the church. You are the church. During this time when we are not able to receive the sacrament of the Holy Eucharist, we can focus on being sacrament for each other, in our congregations, in our families, in our communities. Keep the faith, my friends. The Church of Jesus Christ will outlive any virus, no matter how nasty. Amen. Given all of our talk about the baptismal covenant, I thought it might be a good opportunity for us to renew our own baptismal covenant, to retake the vows. If you are worshiping out of a prayer book, you will find them at page 292, and of course they are always available in the downloadable bulletin. I encourage you to speak the words out loud. This is an important part of our faith. Through the Paschal mystery, dear friends, we are buried with Christ by baptism into his death and raised with him to newness of life. I call upon you, therefore, as we endeavor to practice our faith together while we are yet apart, to renew the solemn promises and vows of holy baptism by which we once renounced Satan and all his works and promised to serve God faithfully in his holy universal church. Do you reaffirm your renunciation of evil and renew your commitment to Jesus Christ? I do. Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, and in the breaking of bread and in the prayers? I will, with God's help. Will you persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord? I will, with God's help. Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ? I will, with God's help. Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself? I will, with God's help. Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being? I will, with God's help. May Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us a new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, and bestowed upon us the forgiveness of sins, keep us in eternal life by his grace, in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
The prayers of the people are according to Form 3, found in the downloaded order of service, or at page 387 of the Book of Common Prayer. Remembering our shared ministry with the worldwide Anglican Communion, we pray the Anglican cycle of prayer, praying especially this morning for the Anglican Communion in Japan. Remembering that we are part of the Episcopal Diocese of Maryland, we pray the diocesan cycle of prayer, praying especially for Epiphany Odenton, St. Albans Glen Burnie, and St. Andrews Pasadena. In the prayers of this parish family, we pray for those celebrating birthdays this week, especially Bill and Christian, and for those celebrating wedding anniversaries, especially Kathy and Ray, Brian and Anne, Susan and Edmund, John and Nora, and Patricia and Scott. We offer prayers of intercession for the Ayers family, for Pete, Cindy, for all healthcare workers, for first responders, for those working essential jobs, students and teachers, and those struggling to do school online, Annie, Naomi, Dolores and Fred, Yvonne, Frederick, Carol, Pam, Tom and John, Joni Beach, Allison, and Fred and Barbara. We offer prayers of thanksgiving for Governor Hogan and for the St. Mark's community. And we offer prayers for the repose of the soul of Donald and Michael. I ask your prayers for God's people throughout the world, for Michael, our presiding bishop, for Eugene and Robert, our bishops, and for Taylor, our priest, and for this gathering, and for all ministers and people. Pray for the church. I ask your prayers for peace, for goodwill among nations, and for the well-being of all people. Pray for justice and peace. I ask your prayers for the poor, the sick, the hungry, the oppressed, and those in prison. Pray for those in any need or trouble. I ask your prayers for all who seek God or a deeper knowledge of him. Pray that they may find and be found by him. I ask your prayers for the departed. Pray for those who have died. Praise God for those in every generation in whom Christ has been honored. Pray that we may have grace to glorify Christ in our own day.
I will add a concluding collect. Let us pray. Gracious God, there is uncertainty all around us. The whole world is in need of prayer. Today we pray for those whose health is compromised by the coronavirus or other health issues, for those who suffer from economic impact of the virus in travel, manufacturing, hospitality, energy, or so many other industries, for healthcare workers and first responders and other public servants who put themselves in harm's way for us, for the political leaders of the world, our countries, the states and cities, as they seek to help manage this challenge. God, we can easily be overwhelmed. But you tell us, do not be afraid. Rekindle our trust in you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. And the peace of the Lord be always with you, and also with you. If you are near somebody who you are allowed to touch, I encourage you to give that person a big hug and offer that person God's peace. We will now say the first portion of the Great Thanksgiving. And we will follow that with the Lord's Prayer and the general thanksgiving from morning prayer. The service will continue then on page 361 if you're using a prayer book. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give God thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is a true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now we will finish up with the general thanksgiving, which you will find at page 101 in the prayer book. Let us pray. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love and the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. May the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and remain with you always. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. And now I invite you to our virtual coffee hour, our Zoom coffee hour. You can get the link. If you go to our homepage, you'll find a link to go to archived announcements. If you go there, you should be able to find the link. Otherwise, just check your own emails. Excuse me, archived emails. So I will look forward to seeing you there.